Hello, everyone, and welcome to Engineering Today. If you're craving for some interesting updates, I bet you aren't going to waste the next few minutes. Let's set go. SpaceX begins assembling the first Starship Super Heavy booster in South Texas. SpaceX has taken the first steps towards orbital Starship launches, starting building of the first Super Heavy booster for recoverable and reusable spaceship missions to Earth orbit and beyond. SpaceX's Starship and Super Heavy will be the largest spacecraft, upper stage, and rocket booster ever built, regardless of their success. CEO of SpaceX, Elon Musk, recently said that a Super Heavy booster could perform hop tests with just two Raptor engines. If necessary, the rocket is ultimately expected to have 20 high-thrust Raptors with minimal throttle capability and an inner ring of 8 throttleable engines for precision controls. SpaceX revealed its first Super Heavy booster, BN-1. The 83-meter tall high bay is under full pressure as teams work to stack and weld the massive steel rocket. Mary of NASASPACEFLIGHT tweeted on the 8th of November, "The Super Heavy booster aft tank section was moved into the high bay at SpaceX Boca Chica." Mary also tweeted on the 9th of November, "The second Super Heavy tank section has been stacked in the high bay. Keep on stacking." On the 22nd of September, first Super Heavy booster rings were seen. In the 6 or so weeks since then, SpaceX's Boca Chica, Texas factory has been continuously producing many sections of stacked booster rings now strewn over the campus. Tank design of two separate Starship prototypes are almost indistinguishable to flight-proven tank design. SpaceX is able to use the exact same manufacturing infrastructure for the vast majority of Starship and Super Heavy. The next generation rocket's booster will most likely be far simpler than the upper stage. It will be the largest reusable spacecraft and upper stage in the world. SpaceX has built a number of small booster prototypes to support Starship's initial orbital flight tests. The design of the Starship tank has been modified further. SpaceX appears to be moving directly from Starship prototype development to full-scale Super Heavy booster production and testing. Within December to January, Super Heavy Booster 1, BN-1, will be completed. Let's move to our next segment. Crew-1 astronauts finally arrived at Kennedy Space Center in Florida 6 days before SpaceX's historic Crew Dragon launch. On Sunday, November 8th, NASA astronauts Victor Glover, Michael Hopkins, and Shannon Walker with JAXA astronaut Soichi Noguchi landed their steps on the Kennedy Space Center just after getting off the plane, which was parked on the former space shuttle runway. "Today we flew here in a plane, but the plan is to leave on a rocket," Glover stated after arriving at the Space Center. Glover is more excited because, unlike Hopkins, Walker, and Noguchi, this will be his first flight. Glover also said, "It's hard to put into words. It's surreal. I'm excited just to go to space. We have an amazing spacecraft and are going to join an amazing team." SpaceX's Crew Dragon launch is scheduled for Saturday, November 14th, at 7:49 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. It will be an 8.5-hour trip to the International Space Station, so if everything goes according to the plan, Crew-1 members will arrive at the station on Sunday, November 15th. After that, the new members will team up with Kate Rubins, Sergei Ryzhikov, and Sergei Kudsherchkov to begin Expedition 64. On October 21st, NASA astronaut Kate Rubins, along with two Russian cosmonauts, arrived at the space station on a Russian Soyuz spacecraft. The director of Kennedy Space Center, Bob Cabana, gave them a warm welcome upon their arrival. "I can't tell you how great it is to welcome a crew here to go to space again," Bob said. Hopkins posted on his Twitter page, "We've been here less than 24 hours, and in that, we've seen our rocket, we've seen our space vehicle, Resilience, and we've seen our space suits. And so for an astronaut, that's considered a pretty good day." This mission marks SpaceX's second crewed flight for NASA after SpaceX's successful Demo 2 flight. It's also the first time that a JAXA astronaut from one of NASA's international partners will be sitting in the capsule with his fellow crew members. As per his third flight to ISS, Noguchi said, "It's such a nice feeling to be here. It's been such a long way, but Crew-1 is in town and we're the only game in town this week." "Our mission is for everyone," said Noguchi. "All for one, one for all, let's go fly." And last, we'll have a quick discussion regarding SLS green test. Technical and weather problems further delay SLS green run test. We certainly continue to make sure that everything is going to go right when we light up all four engines of the Space Launch System, said Jim Morhard, NASA Deputy Administrator, while speaking at the Space Gen Summit Conference on the 7th of November, held by the Space Generation Advisory Council. The test of the core stage of Space Launch System, SLS, is facing another delay due to a mismatch of technical and weather issues that may push back the test to the end of 2020. NASA said that out of 8 valves that supply liquid hydrogen to the stage's 4 RS-25 engines, one valve had erratic functioning during earlier tests. NASA's engineers will replace the valve before proceeding with the final 2 green run tests. A wet dress rehearsal, where the stage is filled with liquid hydrogen and liquid oxygen propellants, and the hot fire test, where the 4 engines will be fired for 8 minutes. NASA also said, following a successful repair, the team plans to conduct the green run, wet dress rehearsal, and hot fire testing before the end of the year. But NASA did not testify particularly when those final 2 green run tests will take place beyond the goal of completing them this year. NASA had scheduled a green run test of the SLS core stage in the middle of November. The date was fixed by officials with NASA and Boeing. NASA announced on the 6th of November that they would delay the green run test of SLS core stage. Hurricane Zeta passed near the Stennis Space Center in Mississippi with a speed of 110 miles per hour, and it gradually weakened. It was the 6th tropical storm to come close enough to Stennis, halting the green run tests, which were taking place on the 28th of October. While the hurricane did not damage the core stage or its test stand, it did cause damage elsewhere at the center and in the local area of habitation. The hurricane poses a serious threat to the employees of NASA. They had faced serious power cuts along with damaging their households. NASA said that due to this natural calamity, many of their employees are not able to come to the Space Center. On October 13th, at a seminar, NASA SLS Program Manager John Honeycutt said that they had 20 to 25 days of margin in a schedule that called for shipping the SLS core stage from Stennis to the Kennedy Space Center in the middle of January. At the time of that seminar, the hot fire test was scheduled for November 14th. Honeycutt also said at the seminar that the SLS core stage was on the critical path for the Artemis 1 mission, and thus any delays with its testing and delivery would delay the mission. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. Hit the like button if you find the video interesting, and kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comment section. This will help us to improve.